second Sunday of Easter at Asbury-St. James United Methodist Church. And we welcome all of those who are watching us as we broadcast on our live stream. And we also encourage you to reach out to the church if you need any prayers or if you need anything in particular. We will be happy to hear from you. And we thank you for watching us each and every Sunday. God is good, and we are back in church. And oh, what a beautiful Sunday we had last week. I want to thank all of you for all the efforts that we came together and really prepare our sanctuary and our Family Life Center in a great way for our Easter egg hunt and so many other things. You will see that a few Easter lilies still adorn the rail of the church. The altar flowers and the lilies on the altar today are given to the glory of God on this second Sunday of Easter. Thanks be to God for his glorious gift. Also, I want to remind you of two things that are upcoming very quickly now. The first is the baptism of Jolie Austin. And Jolie Judith Austin is in church today and with her mom. And the baptism actually is next Sunday, and that would be April the 23rd, not the 26th. So I don't want there to be any confusion there. It's just a misprint in our bulletin this morning. So the 23rd, next Sunday, is baptism of Judith Jolie. Now, you're all invited to reception afterwards, and we look forward to being together. Then the following Sunday, we're going to enjoy our fifth Sunday dinner, and all of the instructions and the needs are before you in your bulletin this morning. So I would just ask if you would go ahead and prepare for that and invite everybody for a great time together. Now let us begin as we bow our heads in prayer. Most dear and heavenly Father, as we come into your house this morning, oh Father, we thank you for the blessings that have been bestowed upon each of us. Oh Father, we understand and we believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Oh Father, now as we begin this day together, bless each and every one of us. And Father, open our hearts, open our minds, and open our lives to the goodness of Jesus our Savior. Amen. And now let us all stand and sing our opening hymn, found on page 176.
Oh,
is found in the middle of first page in your bulletin. Hear the words, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Our hearts are glad, our souls rejoice.
Do not weary, do not be of fear, for Christ is alive.
In this place we find hope and joy.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Let us worship the one who reigns in life.
And our Psalter reading this morning is found on page 748. It is the 16th Psalm. If you would please turn in your Methodist hymnals to page 748, and we will use verses 1 through 11. Actually, 148 is 5 through 11. So let's start on page 748. The way it's broken down, it's only on page 748. Just the verse numbers are wrong. We will use verses 5 through 11. So please respond to the Holy Word of God this morning. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot.
The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a glorious heritage.
I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. Even at night, my heart instructs me.
I said, O Lord, always before me. The Lord is at my right hand.
I shall not be moved.
Therefore, my heart is glad, and my soul rejoices. My body also dwells secure.
For you do not give me up to show, or let your godly ones see the pit.
You show me the path of life.
In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore.
Yeah.
appropriate for us to sing that this morning. That is a great song of commitment, knowing and accepting and acknowledging what Jesus Christ has done for each of us. And we're so unworthy, but he did so much and died on that cross, shed his blood for each of us. And you and I are we're the benefactors of Jesus, God's Son, who gave his entire world and life for the remissions of our sins and eternal life. At Duke, we would often have to take a hymn like this in the hymnology course and decipher every line and then say in our words what it meant to us individually as we have answered the call to preach the Holy Word of God. And so this is a beautiful hymn written in 1707 by Isaac Watts, and it's very Methodist theology, just to let you know as well. It's one of the favorites sung at Duke Chapel in Durham, North Carolina. Now I would like to call Susan Bullock to the altar and to the pulpit, and she would come this morning and read two readings for us, first from Acts and then from 1 Peter.
Proved genuine. When Jesus wraps us all up, it's your faith, not your goal, that God will have on display as evidence of his victory. You never saw him, yet you love him. You still don't see him, yet you trust him. With laughter and singing, because you keep on believing, you'll get what you're looking forward to, total salvation.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Good job.
Let God bless the hearing and understanding of his word today.
Amen. Let people say
amen. Amen. Amen.
Wonderful, wonderful reading. First Peter is wonderful. It tells you why we're here, what we're waiting on, and what we're going to get when we get there. It is a good, positive word. 1 Peter 1, 3 through 9. If you've got your Bible with you today, why don't you go ahead and mark that with a big red star? Because that one works. That's fantastic. Wow, I feel like I just heard a pep rally. Good job. I like that 1 Peter. I like the way Peter writes. I really do. Paul is very theological. Peter is a little more, this is what you're going to get. This is what you did. This is what's coming before you. And I know it's tough sometimes. You said it. Peter said it. I know it's tough sometimes, but it's going to be worth it. Just hang in there. You're going to get what you're going to get. You're going to get it. You're going to love it.
It's really good.
Thank you, Susan. It's time for us to pray. There are many prayers before the church, as always. And today, if you have a prayer request, please just raise your hand and we'll pick it up. Larry's back there. He's the gentleman in the white coat. And looking good in that white coat. And so he's going to pick him up. I'm Charlie. Would you take Larry to the prayer basket, please?
Awesome. Thank you, Dee.
Appreciate it.
And in the meantime, I'm just going to tell you about some prayer requests that we're going to need to cover today. Number one, I want to continue to pray for Dr. Jim Shearer and family. And I want to get where the camera is so they can see me as I pray for their family today. And I'm going to say this already. I'm going to thank God for answered medical procedural prayers. Things seem to be clicking and working. The electrode in the brain and the one in the right side of the chest, this week we're given four different patterns or systems or programs that might help, and they're helping already. They're going to be used, and they're going to see what the results will be for our friend, Dr. Jim Shearer, and his family. Lord, in your mercy, I thank you for answered prayers already. And we continue to pray for all of the people in our church who are undergoing surgery, who are getting ready to have testing, and also who have had a rough week, had some situations. I want to lift up the name also, Rochelle Barnage. Rochelle had knee replacement surgery on Monday. And she got home pretty quickly. She's recovering, dealing with a lot of pain, some discomfort. She and I have been in touch each day, and I've encouraged her. And I know that Larry, her husband, he's here today, and he's certainly doing all he can. So we pray today for her physical therapy that will now take place, and also getting rid of that pain and maybe getting back to normal in terms of the pain meds and this kind of thing. Lord, in your mercy, it is received. Also this morning, we want to look into the prayer basket, and there is a prayer request for Amanda and Nathan Bishop, also Brenna Frederick, and Morgan Griffith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Also this morning, we're asked to pray for Gay Cadell and family, Timothy Shaw, Bernice and Tommy Walters, Barbara Walters, and June Harrell, and all of our shut-ins. Lord, in your mercy, it is received. Also this morning, I will open this prayer request, and I see that it is empty, it's blank, and God knows the situation already and is acting on behalf of this person and the prayer request that's before them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We worship a magical God, a God who knows everything.
and He knows the heart and the minds of everyone. And we believe in the power of an unspoken prayer request that we find in this prayer slip today. Very good. I love the fact that this church does that. Also from Jewel and Sandra, please pray for our uncle, Gordon Sawyer, who was just diagnosed with third stage lung cancer. Prayers for Pastor Tim as he has his skin Mohs surgery tomorrow, and healing prayers for Timothy Shaw's foot as well. And this is from the sisters, Jewel and Sandra. And thank you so much, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers, it is received. Are there any prayer requests also? Kelly?
I would like to say a prayer of thanksgiving. John had a fire in his garage, which was pretty bad.
Yeah.
But it could have been like 10,000 times worse.
Yes.
And it could have moved to the house. And somebody woke up in the middle of the night and saw it. And so I just want to thank God. I told John, as bad as everything looks and smells right now, we thank God those little tennis shoes right there of Emlyn's could have had her feet in them.
You know? Amen. That's right. Kelly, thank you for looking on the bright side of a tragedy. Thank you for having the lens that understands the little blessings that we get around along the way. Sometimes things happen and we say, oh my goodness,
yes,
we'll never make it. But if we look at things through Christ's eyes, we're a blessed people. You hear it, church, Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
Thank you for sharing. That was wonderful. Anyone else this morning? Charlie, you have any prayer requests? Dee? Okay. Desiree Hobbs, she has now moved from St. Francis Hospital to Roper Rehab, and she's going to be getting constant care and rehabilitation, and they're going to be strengthening her and dealing with her her diagnosis. We won't go into what that is, but building her strength up again and her confidence and her balance and so forth. So we just pray God and we thank God for what originally we thought may be a pre-stroke situation, but now we know that that wasn't the case, correct? So we're thanking God for these mercies and these blessings already. Dee and I have been texting through the week, and the other night before I went to bed, I said, you know, I want to pray for Dee's mom. And I said, should I text Dee and tell her I'm praying for mom? It's almost 11 o'clock. And I did, and she immediately texted me back, thank you for the prayers, Tim. So it's never too early or too late to pray, is it? Lord, in your mercy. Yeah, thank you. Anyone else today? Yes, Sam?
Joyce Thomas.
Yeah, I want to pray for Joyce. She was diagnosed with COVID here about 12, 14 days ago now. Continues to have some of the symptoms. She and I have been talking each day. This morning was iffy. She said she may or may not be here, and she's not. And so we continue to pray for her. Right now, she said, just getting up, washing her face and putting on clothes takes all of her energy. So we pray for sustainability. We pray for recovery. We all know, those of us who've had COVID, how devastating it can be in zapping energy. So we pray, thank you, in the name of Joyce, tell us before the church, Lord, in your mercy, it is received. Anyone else this morning? I want to thank God for the fresh dozen eggs that are on my desk. Someone brought me a fresh dozen beautiful eggs this morning that came from their daughter's chicken. Who brought me those? There you go. Thank you so much. Those are Amanda's eggs. And they're fresh from her chicken.
Free-range chickens.
And they're beautiful. Well, I call them, I used to work with Piggy Wiggly, and so I remember what the eggs look like.
They're different colors, but they're all good eggs, and I'm going to give them to you so that I can
help. Wonderful. Thank you so much for that gift. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
All gifts we thank God for. Thank you so much. I appreciate that, Elizabeth Mead. And you tell Amber Mead, Pastor Tim said, thank you for the eggs.
I'm going to have my wife make me some egg salad. And this week, I'm going to have egg salad sandwiches for lunch each day. Sometimes I like to pick the week out for sandwiches. So this week, maybe we think egg salad sandwiches okay? Okay. Lord, have mercy. Thank you. God bless you. If there are no other prayer requests, let us bow our heads as we now go to the Lord in prayer. And I want to just start by saying, I want to thank God for the visitors that we had last week. And I know that there were many people who were blessed. I gave out one cross last Sunday because that's all I had. And a couple came through the back door and I'd never seen them before. They told me who they were. And God said, they're the ones. Reach in your pocket and give them the one cross that you have left. And I did. Well, she sought me out this week. And boy, was she impressed with all of y'all. She thinks this church is really something. I don't know how she even found this. But she's planning on being back. They live in another town. But I have a feeling she's watching us today online. So I thank God for all of them. I thank God for all of you. And all that we do in the name of Jesus Christ. I received a letter yesterday from a young man from Atlanta. He said, I was in Charleston and wanted to come to your church again. I wanted to hear Easter at Asbury. I stayed an extra day. I wanted to hear what you preached on. And he sent a nice check and a long letter about the people at Asbury-St. James. He's a former Charleston boy that lives in Atlanta, Georgia. He said, Tim, continue to bless the people. And y'all just keep praying that God does what God does. And I guarantee him that God shows off at Asbury-St. James. You never know what God's going to do. He's got great things in store for all of us. Amen. You know, I believe that on Sunday morning, we are a people of great opportunity. If we'll just open up our eyes, we'll see what God has planned for each of us. And I think about that little baby that's sitting back there, little Jolie, sitting there with her mama Katie right now. What a glorious Sunday it's going to be next week when we stand before God and dedicate Jolie to God. And we take the oath that we're going to support Jolie also all the days of her life and guide her and teach her and love her. And now let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, the prayers are before you this day. Oh, Father, we're already receiving them. Now we're going to ask you to bless them. Oh, Father, anybody, anywhere that hears our voices, the prayers before the people, the petitioning of the pastor, oh, Father, let it be blessed by God himself, and let God's will be done. Oh, Father, that is our prayer this day. And now let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. And now let us worship God with our tithes and our offerings. As Herb plays a beautiful song for us today, let us come forward and put our offerings in the Lord.
And just like the people in the Old Testament, they would come and give what you had given to them. And we continue to do that today. Oh, Father, just please accept them and use them and make them the bread of life for those that are in need, for those who are starved, not necessarily for physical hunger, but need the spiritual gifts of Jesus. We take these in Jesus' name now. Amen. The church may be seen. Church would be so kind as to join me in the words of assurance. They are found on page 2 of the bulletin this morning. And it starts off with Jesus said to. So now you're ready to say it. Here we go. Jesus said to the disciples, if you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. Beloved children of God, you are forgiven. May this forgiveness bring peace to your souls, your mind, and your body. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now on this second Easter, the second Sunday of Easter, last week we came and we celebrated the risen Christ. So here we are gathered on the second Sunday of Easter. Let us hear the rest of the story after the resurrection of Jesus the Christ. I will be reading from, of course, the Gospel according to St. John. In the 20th chapter, I will start with verse 19, and I will proceed through verse 31. Just so that you know, I am reading from the Message Bible, and that is Eugene Peterson's translation of the Bible in what we know as today's more common language. We made this translation available to all of you in the church. I spoke before the Board of Ordained Ministry on Tuesday, and one of the things that I talked about was how important teaching and learning is in the life of the church. And I was so brave as to say, I've always been amazed at how long people go to church but don't really know the story of the Bible. They hear bits and pieces, but they don't know the whole story. And I gave the explanation that through this Bible, it is spoken so clearly, the Message Bible. Elise, I don't believe you've been given one of these yet, but guess what? You got a Bible coming to you. And I appreciate you being here Maundy, Thursday, Easter Sunday, and back again today. And I pray for you and John. So let's look into the Message Bible this morning and see what the next thing Jesus does. I can tell you something. This is really exciting. Later on that day, after the resurrection of Jesus the Christ, the disciples had gathered together. Because they were fearful of the Jews, when they were in the room, they had locked all of the doors of the house. Jesus entered. He stood among them and said, "Peace to you." Then he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples, seeing the master with their own eyes, were exuberant. Jesus repeated his greeting, "Peace to you." And just as the Father sent me, I send you. Then he took a deep breath and he breathed into them. He said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive someone's sins, they're gone for good. If you don't forgive their sins, what are you going to do with them?" But Thomas, called the twin, also known as Didymus, one of the 12 disciples, was not with them when Jesus entered and came into the room. The other disciples told him later, "Thomas, we have seen the Master." But he said, "Oh, unless I see the nail holes in his hands and put my finger in the holes and stick my hand in his side, I simply will not believe it."
8 days later, his disciples were again in that same room. This time, Thomas was with them. Jesus came once again through the locked doors, stood among them, and said, "Peace to you." And probably in Aramaic or in Hebrew would have said, "Shalom." Then he focused his attention on Thomas. "Thomas, take your finger and examine my hands. Take your hand and stick it in my side. Don't be unbelieving, Thomas. Believe." Thomas then said, "My master, my God." And Jesus said, "Oh, so you believe because now you have seen with your own eyes. Even better blessings are in store, listen church, for those who believe without seeing." Jesus provided far more God-revealing signs than are written down in this book. These are written down so you will believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and in the act of believing, you will have real and eternal life in the way He personally revealed it. This is the Word of God. It has been read and presented to the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Most dear and heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of every heart gathered in this room today be acceptable in your holy name. Amen. So here we are. We're gathered together in the same church as last week. The situation is different. It's not Easter Sunday. There's not quite as many people. There's not the excitement of an Easter egg hunt afterwards. The flowering cross is still out front. It's not up here. And a lot of the Easter lilies have been taken home. I personally took my three home and already planted them around the big flower bed by the mailbox that has a statue of Mother Mary in it. And they are having a blast, those Easter lilies, dancing around Mother Mary this morning and through all this rain that we've had this week. And we gather to celebrate the appearance today of Jesus the Christ after his victory over death on the cross. We know through the gospel accounts that Jesus appeared at least 10 times post-resurrection to his disciples. Biblical scholars would say the number is actually more like 12 times. The saying goes, seeing is believing. John Wesley in his notes wrote this in regards to Jesus appearing to people after his death and resurrection. John Wesley wrote it like this, and I really enjoy this because I'm a Wesleyan. "A sign of Jesus Christ will gladden the heart of a disciple at any time, and the more we see of Jesus, the more that we rejoice." But one disciple, as I have read to you today, missed the opportunity, and his response to the disciples was this, when he said, "I will believe only when I see. I must see the Lord. I will believe it only when I can see." And even added her, "and I want to touch it." What would you have done if you missed the Bible study this morning and Jesus appeared? What would you say? What if I came out of the church family life center, ran over here to the pulpit and said, "Yeah, Jesus is over in the gymnasium. I just saw him." How would we react? Think about it in the people of that day. Secondly, I believe that we are all still seeing Christ appear around and through our lives today. The scripture tells us that he will appear to us and through us in many, many ways. But in the meantime, many of us are doubting Thomas. Can somebody say amen? Amen. So now I want to start phase two. Do you ever have doubts? And I'm not just talking about doubts of everyday things, but I'm talking about doubts about faith-related matters. This week, I sent many of you a message on text, which included a picture of a sky with soft, fluffy clouds. And in those clouds, the words were written, "We are too blessed to be stressed." How many of you received that and remember that? Yes. And Sandra responded, and Mary responded and said, "Oh, I have to remember that, and I need to receive it, and I need to live it. I need to receive it, and I need to live it, and I need to not be a doubter, but I need to be a doer of the gift that Jesus has given to us." All of us at some point during each day of our waking hours have doubts about our circumstances. Wouldn't you say that's true? I think that's very true. We all have doubts. We talked about our doubts in our Bible study on Sunday mornings over there. We talked about some of the different ideas and different ways that people receive Jesus as they're coming up. And each of us, each of you, have a different image of who Jesus is in your lives. But today I hear Thomas, also known as Didymus, also known as Doubting Thomas, saying, "Doubts are who I am. Doubts is where I am in my life with Jesus right now." You know, I wonder what happened to Thomas. Was he getting an extra cup of coffee? What was he doing in that situation where he missed out on the first appearance of Jesus the Christ after he appeared in front of the two Marys? It appears Thomas the disciple had an issue with doubt, church. Let me ask you today, are you a doubter or are you a doer? Let me ask you this, and I'm going to read a few things to you. Now, if you know who said this, go ahead and just shout it out. How many of you have heard the following by a very famous person, and you can identify who said this? This person was asked, and I believe I saw it on 60 Minutes. He was asked this question: "Do you believe that after you die, you will hear God say to you, 'Well done, my good and faithful servant'?" And after a long pause, he responded, "I certainly hope so." Y'all know who that was asked of and who responded? It was Billy Graham. Or from the Gospel of Luke: "How can I be sure of this? For I am an old man, and my wife is well along in years." You remember who said that? It was Zachariah. In response, when the angel Gabriel appeared to Zachariah and said, "Zachariah, something huge is getting ready to happen in your life. Your wife Elizabeth, who has been barren her whole life, is getting ready to have a child. And you're going to name him John. And I'm going to give you a hint. His name is going to be John the Baptist." And Zachariah looked back at Gabriel the angel and said, "What are you talking about?" And Gabriel said, according to the scriptures, "Zachariah, because you have questioned my authority, you're going to have the inability to speak for the next 9 months." And Zachariah was unable to speak until the baby was born. And he wrote down on a tablet when all the people from the synagogue came for the circumcision and said, "You are going to name him Zachariah, aren't you?" And he wrote down on the tablet, "No, his name will be John, not Zachariah." Because the tradition of the Jewish male would be that the firstborn, particularly it being a man, boy, would be named after the father. And he said, "No, it's going to be John." And the whole synagogue was in an uproar. "Who is this John that Zachariah has given birth to with his wife Elizabeth? It's already a miracle." And when they named him John, Zachariah was able to speak again. You see, I believe that we are all just one step away from a miracle in our lives if we would just not doubt it, but that we would accept it. And who said this when Gabriel, the angel, came and spoke to her? "How can this be?" Now, you all know that. Who was it? Mary. It was Mother Mary. Saints, our faith must be greater than our doubts, or we are unable to move forward because of fear. I'm going to tell you a little story, and I'm going to walk away from the pulpit. and I'm going to turn this way. When I first came to Asbury-St. James, I was quickly learning about people. And I would say to you that I definitely had an older congregation right from this set behind me. And there were two little ladies that sat together each and every Sunday, and I would watch them very carefully because I could tell they were also watching me. And they didn't say much, but they talked back and forth to one another when I would be conducting my sermon. And I would say things that had what I would refer to as a very upbeat and positive outlook. I am a visionary. I believe in dreams. I am a dreamer. And I dream because I know that most of my dreams come true. And I never fall short of a dream that God has put in my heart. Well, I would notice that sometimes that I would be preaching and I would say, I believe in the future that we're going to have a new roof in this building, that we're going to have new carpet, and we're going to have new roofs on all of the buildings, and that people will once again come back to the church, and that we will do magnificent ministry in the name of Jesus Christ the Savior. And then I would see them. And I would say, Lord, I wonder what they're saying. Do they believe me? Or are they doubters? So one day I was in a meeting and I ran across the two ladies and they were here and I kind of overheard their conversation and said, did you hear what the pastor said? He thinks that this is going to happen. And I heard the other one say, well, I'll believe that when I see it. Now the rest of the story, as Paul Harmon said. I was at my store one day and the telephone rang and it was the, and when you get there, we'll all be seated eating breakfast before the prayer speaker speaks for the morning. And I want you to walk up, don't say anything, and just sit down next to her in the chair. Well, church, I did exactly as he asked. I put on my best suit. I got up about 5:30 because I knew the traffic from West Ashley to the North Charleston Coliseum could be pretty heavy at 5:26 at 6 o'clock in the morning. And I want to be there about 6:45. I want to follow the man's invitation and his orders. So I walked into a room with 1,000 people and he said, our table is at the front. And I said, ooh, he paid a lot for that table. And I walked down the aisle and I went right up to the table and I looked at what I knew was my friend from the church and I just pulled the chair out and sat down next to her. And she looked at me and just started laughing and crying. You see, she doubted, but when I showed up that morning, oh Lord, was she happy to see me. You know, I think sometimes in our lives, that same story is taken over many, many times. She became one of my closest friends here at the church. When I did her funeral services, it was one of the most, well, it was a special service that I did that day for her and her family. And I know now that she saw in me over the years the ability to complete a lot of the dreams that I had for this church over the past 19 years, as I was reminded on Tuesday in front of the Board of Ordained Ministry. And I believe that we will have a spirit of doing and not doubting, that we're going to be a lot better off. When I was a boy, I loved Saturday morning cartoons. How many of you watch Saturday morning cartoons as children? How many of you still watch them as parents or grandparents? Yeah. You know, one of my favorite cartoons was Gulliver's Travels. I used to love to watch Gulliver's Travels about the Lilliputians and 6 foot tall Gulliver and listen to how Tom Swift's story was portrayed in that little book. One of the Lilliputians was a guy named Flimnap. You remember Flimnap? He was one of the Lilliputians, 6 inches tall. Do you remember what Flimnap always said? I thought about this week when I was writing a sermon.
He said one thing he was known for. He had a little sleepy face, he wore a hat down over his eyes, and he said this every cartoon.
We'll never make it. Y'all know where I'm headed, don't you? Can't you just see Thomas standing before the 11 disciples saying, you guys are lost. I don't know what you think you saw, but you didn't see Jesus. And until I see him and put my fingers in the nail marks, and I stick my hand in the side where that Roman centurion took that spear and stuck it in his sack, I'm not going to believe him. Well, Flimnack used to always say, we'll never make it. Well, I'm just an 8-year-old boy, gay. And guess who I couldn't stand on Gulliver's Travels? Flimnack, because he had no faith. At a very young age, I didn't even know what theology was. But I realized that it takes faith to live. Without faith, we are dead. Without works, we have no faith. And I think that Flimnack was one of those people that live in life, and you and I run across them all the time. You'll never make it. That church isn't coming back. That church is dead as it can be. So you see, I believe that Gulliver's Travels was a fantastic theologically written symbolism type cartoon. Today, let's be clear. There is a difference between doubt and unbelief. Doubt is, I can't believe in what I think I saw, and unbelief is, I will never believe. Doubt means I'm looking for the light. Unbelief is I'm content with walking in the darkness. By refusing to doubt, you are saying nothing is impossible with God. Let me encourage you today. Do you feel lost or do you feel lonely? Nothing is impossible with God. Do you feel unloved? Do you feel like that you have nothing else to do, that you don't have any purpose left in your life? I have good news this morning. Nothing is impossible with God. Are you sick? Are you tired? Is your body worn out? Have you forgiven and forgotten who you are and whose you are? Nothing is impossible with God. Let me just close by saying, if God created this world, and he placed you and I in it, and he gave his only son as our savior to establish his reign over all of the earth, how can we lose? How can we be doubters? Can we agree that we are given to be receivers of God's love? We've been given his care. We've been given the promises of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. But let me close by saying the final two sentences. There is a requirement. You just don't get it because you're a good girl or a pretty boy or your family's successful or you grew up on the right side of town. You have to be obedient to God and His Son. It requires submissive obedience and it requires radical commitment. Let us be doers, not doubters. For Christ came, he lived, and he's alive forevermore. All I ask you today on this second Sunday of Easter is to believe and receive. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, this is the good news of Jesus the Christ. This is the gospel, and we are to rejoice because we are your chosen people. The tables have turned. We know what is in front of us, and we come on Sunday just setting the table to get ready for the final supper. We know that you're going to take care of each one of us, and you're blessing us along the way. Oh, Father, never let us be doubters, but be doers of Christ's word. Amen. And now let us stand before God and turn in our final hymn this morning. This is a magnificent song. Herb has chosen a beautiful one today. It's hymn number 156. Let us stand before God and sing together. I love to tell the story. Page 156.
each and every Sunday, we come to tell the story. Many of you have heard it so many times over and over, but it never gets tired of being heard, does it, Pauline? You just shake your head and say, tell it, Tim. Tell me the story again, because I love to hear it. You see, so many people in the world today, y'all, do not know the story. How can you love a story that you know nothing about? Matthew 28 tells us the great commission of Jesus Christ before he ascended into heaven was he said to the disciples as they stood at his feet and watched him go up into the clouds. He said, now go out into all the nations and baptize in the name of the Father and the name of the Son and the name of the Holy Spirit and taught and teach them everything that I have taught you. That's what we need to do. We got to do that. We got to do it in a powerful way. We're going to start by doing it next Sunday about 11:35 with Jolene Judith Austin. Y'all know Jolene is already hearing me preach. She already knows my voice. She's already heard the Word of God. And she will hear it the rest of her life. We are a blessed people. Now go out and receive it. Be doers, don't be doubters. I don't want to hear anybody shaking their head when I'm up there preaching about something that's going to happen. Because I saw it happen. We put a new roof on this building. We put new carpet in this church. We removed every pulpit and every pew out of this church and reconditioned. I don't think y'all heard.
Amen.
Praise God.
On my birthday, July the 3rd, 19 years ago, I came to this church and did a funeral for Harry Kent, a.k.a. Mr. Methodist, known as by the South Carolina Conference. And I was in the pulpit with two other ministers who were in their late 60s or early 70s. The ceiling was peeling so bad that pieces of it were falling down during the service. One of the high-powered ministers, and there was about 20 of them here, this place was packed, said to me, son, aren't you the minister here? And I said, yes, sir. I've just been appointed. He said, you need to do something about that ceiling. And I've carried that around for the last 20 years. Guess what?
You did it.
We did it.
We did it.
Because we were doers and not doubters. And we never gave up. Sometimes we're ready to give up before God's ready to give up. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And now it's time to go home. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Spirit, may he be and abide with you now and forevermore. Amen.